So you make a number in.
Well, I told her.
Well, and then they'll still do it and go, why did you look who's here. Hey, buddy. How are you? Hey, buddy.
That's good.
Did you say good morning to me? You're too cute to be a crab out. Give me that. I got it. Sasha, go. Oh.
What's funny doing?
Almost smiled. No smiles. No smiles. Alright, we got it. Oh, he gets five and I didn't. Oh, I had to wake you up first, I guess.
Well, because like you said, we were all just here.
I got this one.
And I turned that off already. So it's the
fellowship, and just listening to you.
your hearts. In His and my name we place them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone. How's everybody doing today?
Great.
All right. So, for heaven's sake, there's a couple typos in here. First one, I'm going to apologize to Michelle for it. You look inside the front cover and the end of the notes section. The top of the sketch 418, that should say Memorial for Cheryl Hall. Immediately following service today, we'll be having a memorial for Cheryl. Michelle's sister passed away a week ago this past Thanksgiving Day. And following the memorial, we'll have a potluck. I see the table is filling up quite nicely with lots and lots of food, so there'll be plenty. So please join us, even if you didn't bring anything today. Speaking of Thanksgiving, I want to thank everyone who was here and who provided food. We had just a little over 80 folks here, and in fact, as we were tearing down, we got a phone call. And a gentleman who came, and another gentleman, they didn't come together. They came separately, but they came at the same time, which is really neat. They were from the neighborhood, and they were both able to not only get a great Thanksgiving dinner, we didn't have any turkey left as a surprise. We still had ham and all the other fixings. But they were able to take some food home. And the one gentleman had a daughter, an adult daughter, who couldn't come, so he was able to bless her. So it was a beautiful, beautiful day with our church family from here and St. Mark's. So again, thank you. Now, Catch 419 is this coming Friday night. Chris, what do we have?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. Okay. If you'll, some of you have noticed in the upcoming events that it says December 6th, take a pen, pencil, scratch that out with the 5th. I was talking to Chris earlier. What I do is, this list is way down here, and as things disappear off the top, the list comes up. That was the 6th, before we changed it. So that's why that's wrong in there. And then, really the last thing that I have is in a couple of weeks, we'll be having Mission of Hope service at Mission of Hope. But we're going to be in their new building, and I thought I'd put a picture in here so everybody could see it. It's at 1700 B Avenue Northeast.
B and 17th.
Right. So, yeah, if you turn by the Hy-Vee on First Avenue, you're going to be, go down to B, you'll find it very easily. This is a storied building, just as this one is. It started out as Central Park Presbyterian Church. And so now...
And a lot of the buildings are going to be
they're using a big portion of it, but a lot of it's going to be used for other nonprofits.
Yes.
They've already, I think, right, wrong.
Which is a history of that building. Whoever has owned that building from Central Park on has let other ministries come in and use rooms and offices in the education wing, areas that they didn't need. But if you've been to Mission Hope on First Avenue, you know how small their eating area is, okay? It is, what, a third, maybe a quarter size of our fellowship hall? And now it's at least twice, if not three times bigger. So they've got a really great... Go out to the website, go to the Facebook page, you have lots of pictures out there of what's going on. And so today's a little beginning of Advent. So as everybody knows, we started taking the offering right after the children's time during the first song, right after the third song, right before the sermon, we'll do the Advent lighting. So some different things going on today, but we're glad we're all here. Tomorrow's supposed to be a little bit of snow possibly, but it's going to be a great week. It's going to be a great God week. And it's going to be a great Christmas season. So let's get up and greet each other.
Crazy! It's pretty cool how you do that, right?
Think about what they can do to help get our budget, help set up the computer lab for the 3D program we want to get started. And Lord, we just thank you for having two teachers call us in the last 2 weeks, offering to volunteer their time. You're a good God, Lord, and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Everyone says, amen. Come on now.
This power is strong, this solid ground. Thank you.
place is so unwell.
No, it's on my chair.
Father God, as we get ready to hear your message today, and today being the first day of Advent, we call you to be with us, to touch our souls and our hearts, so we can just inhale, just get it in. We're always giving out. And when we give out in that way, Lord, we're giving out us, not you. You're pushing us, our agenda. Our personality, we can say it's our personality, that's who I am. If you can't accept me and my personality, oh well. Because Lord, when we ingest and inhale you, our personalities change. And I want to change today for all of us, including me. I need to make some big changes in my life. I want to start today, and I want everyone else to. Just to love you and know you and seek you. When we seek you, we find you. When we find you, we fall more in love. Be with us today, this first day of Advent, this message, and let people just start ingesting, inhaling. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please be seated. Oh, wait, you already are. Today being the first day of Advent, it's a special time between now and Christmas. And if you're not sure what Advent is, I'm going to give you a little blurb in a minute, but look it up. Google it. Check it out. Really check out what it is, what Advent means. And I think if you do that, it's going to alter your day. Can I get you guys to come up to the Capitol after this? Each Sunday leading up and including Christmas Eve, we light candles. We're going to explain what they are. This being the first week of Advent, do I have a mic next to me? I'm going to use James' mic.
Today is the first Sunday of Advent. Sunday in which we are all hope we have in Christ. The hope we have in Christ. The prophet of Israel all spoke of the coming of Christ, of how a Savior would be born. Kingdom line of David. He spoke of how he would rule the world wisely and bless all nations.
On Christmas Day, the Christ of our hope was born. On Friday, the Christ of our hope died. On Easter Day, the Christ of our hope rose from the dead. He then ascended into heaven. And on the last day, the Christ of our hope will come again to establish his kingdom over all things on earth. As a follower of Christ, we await his return. We light this candle to remember that he has came to us and humbly in the manger of Bethlehem and gave light to the world. So he is coming again in power to deliver his people.
We light this candle to remind us to be alert and to watch for his return. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the hope you give us. Help us prepare our hearts for the Lord's coming. Bless our worship. Help us live holy and righteous lives. We ask in the name of the one born in Bethlehem. Amen.
Thank you. Yes, James, Mike. Good job, guys. Thank you so much. Considering I just asked them to do this last week, good job. During this Advent season, Terry and I prayed a lot about getting their hearts to know what Advent is. So we're following that theme of
Christmas. And the title of this is Hope is on the Way. Today we're going to talk about managing expectations. How do you manage those? But first we're going to start a little bit about Advent. It's the beginning of the church year for most churches in the Western tradition. It starts on the fourth Sunday before Christmas and ends on Christmas Eve. And in some traditions, if Christmas Eve is on a Sunday, they include that as the fourth Sunday and Christmas Eve. The word Advent literally means coming or arrival. That's what the word means. So the focus of the entire season is really on the celebration of two things. The birth of Jesus, which is the first Advent, right? The first coming. And then also the anticipation of the return of Christ, which we're going to call the second Advent. So really it's past and forward. You follow me? And it's a celebration both ways. Would you not agree? Fix the noise. Would you not agree? There you go. So Advent is a way then of trying to make a 2,000-year-old history lesson seem real. Because we know the Advent is coming, you know what I mean? So it's not just a historical stamp. So let's think about that moving forward. It's Advent is a double focus. And I know for some of us that even know what Advent is, we may not have thought about it that way. But it's a double focus. It also symbolizes a spiritual journey of individuals and the congregation of the church as they or we affirm that Jesus has come, that he is present in the world today, and that he's going to come back again, reigning in power. And we don't think about that sometimes. So as we wait in anticipation, we also should recognize our personal church responsibility, the biblical church responsibility. And really, it all stems from one thing that God shared with us, and that was, love the Lord your God with all your heart. And love your neighbors as yourself. And people, if you do those two things, everything else goes into play. Everything else makes you share and be a better person. Now I know sometimes it's hard to love our neighbors. It took 3 years for me to love on the one next door to mine. Truly. But we were destined to have a relationship with her. As mean and honoring as she was. And now we just love her. And she does. We took just set the example of putting up with craziness, you know. Week after week, and hosing my dogs and all these things. Hussing at my wife. All this craziness. That's a baby, we're not going to react. We're going to respond. And now, give waves, she'll come over and say hi. It's almost, I wish you wasn't talking to sometimes. But you know what, that's what God did. It's nothing we did. So during this Advent season, think of things like that. Think of someone like that, a situation like that. Maybe someone you're harboring something against. Because you love yourself. If we're following God's word, right? And we love ourselves and our neighbor, everything else comes into play. So guys and gals, I want you to hear this. While some churches, a lot of churches, really focus on repenting and repentance during Advent, that's their whole focus. And don't get me wrong, there's still a great place for that. It's part of the season. The spirit of the expectation of the Old Testament, though, I think, is better captured with a joyful sense of expectancy. You know what I mean? A happy way. I can't wait for the second Advent. And we wouldn't be who we were today without the first Advent. Amen. So rather than a time of mourning and sadness and fasting, I want Advent. I think it should be celebrated as a time of joy and happiness as we wait for him. Really, I think that's what it should be. There'll be plenty of time during the rest of our journey throughout the year and weeks to remember and reflect and repent our sins. Let's make this a happy time. So in saying that, we celebrate with gladness the great promise of Advent, which means what? The coming or arrival. Yet knowing that there's also going to be some somber tone as the theme of the threat is added to the theme of the promise.
that will be reflected in some of the scripture readings during this Advent season, in which there's a strong prophetic tone of accountability and judgment of sin, which we don't talk about a lot. But Pastor Terry and I decided that we need to really explain it biblically. But there's also a faithful heart that comes with waiting on our coming Lord. A promising heart, an excited heart. And I'll tell you, I'm so glad I know the love of the Lord. How about you? So the wreath, the circle of the wreath reminds us of God himself. The ring, can everyone see that? Okay. I'm just kind of looking at that area. I'll do some of my hand things. So the circle of the wreath means God himself and the eternity and endless grace and mercy that he extends. It also recognizes with God there's no beginning and no end. The green of the wreath speaks of the hope that we have in God, the hope of newness, of renewal, eternal life. And the candles symbolize the period of waiting during the four Sundays of Advent, the four outer candles, which themselves also symbolize four centuries of waiting, four centuries between the prophet Malachi and the birth of Jesus Christ. 4 centuries, that's a long time, huh? The center candle is called the Christ candle, and it's traditionally lit on Christmas Eve. So I hope that explained a little bit about that, huh? But like I said, look it up. Study it a little bit. Parts of it are kind of good, but they're exciting to really understand the meaning of this time. So today, managing unexpectations. We're going to be in the book of Matthew, for those of you that have a Bible, in chapter 24, and we're going to be going between like verses 36 and 44. If you'd like to follow along in the Bible and you didn't bring one, there should be one of them. If he was in front of you, if not, raise your hand and we'll get you one. Right away in the season of Advent, our seasonal narrative truly begins to unfold with Jesus himself prophesying of his own coming. That's right, Jesus, the Word made flesh among his followers, is telling people to be watchful, almost warning people to be ready, because they have no idea when the Savior is going to come again. And you know, that's something only God knows, and that's something only God still knows. It's no different than it was then. It seems very backward, though, to me. And you can imagine the questions Jesus must have gotten after that prophetic moment when he talked about his coming back. I mean, he heard things like, wait a minute, what are you talking about? You're sitting right here. I mean, could you imagine the confusion, maybe? Aren't you the one we've been waiting for? Aren't you our Messiah? Why would you leave and come back? So people were riddled. And it riddled me when I ran into this little bit of study. And I kind of thought, oh, if I was one of the disciples, maybe I would have thought the same thing. Jesus, why? You're here. Stop it already. For the community of Matthew around this time, you can get the sense that with the writing of this gospel, that they felt that the end time was imminent. But I think they expected it immediately. You know what I mean? That'd be like me coming up to you and saying, Jamie and I are house hunting. We want to buy a house. We're going to buy a house. Cool. Then I don't run into you for a year or two, or a month, or whatever. And you say to me, how do you like the house? Oh, we're going to buy a house. You're telling us. We're going to buy a house. So some of these guys are confused. So, the kingdom was coming, and soon, so they were to be ready. This is what Jesus told them now, Matthew. They were to keep watch and not get caught by the thief. Now, let's say it, right? You follow me? That's what Jesus told them to do. So they're preparing and getting ready for all this. Now, if Jesus told you to do that, wouldn't you think it's immediate? OK, okay, we need to get ready, we need to start watching, we need to make sure our lives are checked, we need to be ready and not battle against him, we need to not accept the thief, and get on a straight line. The passage is in the midst, though, of a long prophetic message that Jesus gave. And he was telling the disciples that they were heading down a violent road. Now, in this passage, when Jesus is giving this warning, heeding this warning, this is doing a big time prophetic stuff that he was preaching from the Mount of Olives. Make a note of that. Mount of Olives. So I want you to do some study and look up that a little bit, okay? So during this time when he's doing this with the Mount of Olives, he says this. Then you will be arrested, persecuted, and killed. You'll be hated all over the world. Why? Because you are my followers. People, how many times do we catch flies following Jesus? Nobody think about something else. How many times do you alter your behavior and not represent Jesus to not get flagged? You know what I'm saying? I'll bet you the latter of the two is more common. And somehow we have to shift that. You follow me? So how many times do we get flagged and get rid of people because of our relationship and love for Jesus Christ? Versus how many times do we shift who we are so we don't get flack and ridicule because of our relationship with Jesus? Do we sell out? I want you to think about that. You know, you may not be facing intense persecution right now like they were there. I can do that. But Christians in other parts of the world are. As you hear about Christians suffering for their faith, getting killed for saying, I love Jesus Christ. As we learned during that radical series, what did we talk about? When you go into these churches that they had to hide and travel days to get there and do it in the dark. Remember that they're your brothers and sisters in Christ too, people. Pray for them, yeah? Pray for the ones who persecute. When Christians hear, are in pain or trouble or fall, pick them up. Don't kick them when they're down. So often we do that. When they're down in the dumps and no one wants to help and people are fed up, we walk away. We don't forgive. We don't extend a tenth of the grace that God gives us. And there's other times where we do, right? Right? So is there times that we don't?
Yes.
Make some noise?
Yes.
Is there times that we do?
Yes.
Do you know what that is? It's not about him, it's all about you. If we're picking and choosing who we're going to pick up and who we're going to kick, that's not God. Now you're going, oh man, I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have said you have it. Think about it. I told you, the season's heaven. And it really changes our hearts. If you think you have the right to be mad or hold a grudge, think again. Let me tell you that when one part of the body suffers, whatever, the whole body suffers. But when all parts join together, it eases the suffering and the whole body benefits. Amen? Why can't we do that more often? In order. Write down grace. Take a note. I want you to look that up too. I'm going to give you a lot of lookups this week. And speaking frankly, I hear a lot of bickering and negative stuff all the time. Here, neighborhood, community, here, church. All the time. And people getting mad at this or that. Getting mad at me. Getting mad at Terry. We didn't do this. We didn't do that. We didn't do this. Not, hey, you did do that. Hey, we're doing something right. People are giving their lives to Christ. The neighborhood's starting to come slowly. But they're getting mad at you and me and leaving the church or infecting the church and really If we're a family of God, we should be extending grace and patience and love and working things out as family does. You know what I'm saying? We forgive family, don't we? Eventually, sometimes it takes a bit. We need to do that here. We're a family. Think of a song like this. A song I think of. Right? Anyway, we are a family. We need to live like a family. If you got a problem with one of your family members, what do? You take it to them, right? Or you give it to them, one of the two. We need to do that here, people. If we got issues with each other, let's fix them. We got work to do. Amen? And that's not me. We have work to do. Every one of us. We should be shown in a love family relationship and encouraging each other. It's just a lot to say. Don't think about it. So from his telling the disciples that they were heading down a violent road to signs of the coming of Jesus, he also warned in Matthew 24:29, immediately after the anguish of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will give no more light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. That's a heavy verse. So he's telling the disciples to get ready, right? To be ready, get ready, be watchful. Don't take the thief, and when I come, you'll know it. That's pretty powerful stuff. And he's prophesying on himself. This is what God is. You see what I'm saying? This is a heavy, heavy scripture. Jesus has a whole vision of time before him laid out. And he offers commentary on his own life and mission from the Mount of Olives. He's offering a prophetic preview of what's to come. He's issuing a challenge to those who would follow him, right? So these guys are following him, are going to follow him, follow his along with him. And he's saying, I love you, and I want you to follow me. I want you to trust me. Give your life to me, like some of us have a hard time doing. Your whole life. Lay down your fish, lay down your poles, come with me. So after they're together for a little while, he decided, they came to him. He said, now I need to tell you what's going to happen. Right? He gave warning. He gave love. But he didn't hold back. Jesus always walked in truth and love, did he? Always. You couldn't say he didn't love. They couldn't say he didn't love. Couldn't. So sometimes people, when we have to be truthful, we need to do it in love, not attack. I noticed something here, something that the early church seemed to grasp way better than we do today. Our early church brothers and sisters really expected these words of Christ to come to pass. They believed it was going to happen. That's why when they wrote this down, that's why they wrote it down. You see what I'm saying? Track lineage of what's going on. So they didn't sit around. They were busy. They were busy sharing the gospel. They were busy sharing the love of Jesus. Because remember, Jesus shared with a number, right? And then sent them out to share with a number. And then out to share with a number. Then out to share with a number. People were busy. These words were written down in the midst. You've got to realize this is a dangerous time for the early church. Dangerous time. In the midst of a community that was persecuted, and where was it safe to be a Christian in a lot of places? We still have that going on today, folks. In the Holy Land, too. But these words were written with great care for those that would call themselves followers. They truly didn't want to see anybody left behind. They didn't want to see anyone left behind. So it was their mission to share the love of Christ with everyone they came in contact with. And it didn't matter to them if they were at work, at the store, getting caught off in traffic, you know, horses almost, or whatever, yeah, whatever they were driving. Those areas didn't make a difference to them, people. They did it everywhere, all the time. We have so many excuses, don't we? I won't be accepted in that crowd if I don't, you know, cuss here and there. Can't talk about it at work because it's taboo. Stop it. Find a way. What are those people doing in China? Walking days to be in a church with no electricity. Sometimes getting killed going and coming. But we're afraid to wear a cross of work. Isn't that weird? I'm not afraid to wear a work. And I'm not afraid to blab it everywhere I go. I mean, we've been in situations, Carrier, where we've been picketed. Ron knows. We go back a long way. I've known Ron probably since I moved here. He's a good friend. Ron is one of the main people for organizing, doing anything they need. We've been persecuted. To me, when we're getting picketed and having things thrown at us and all these things going on because we're in a park on a national day of prayer, I'm like, bring it on. Because you can't fight the spiritual God. And there's nothing better than 60 or 70 or 80 people praying for the government, the community, our leaders, our neighborhoods, our homes. And I got to tell you real quick, for some of you who didn't hear, it was all over the paper these years ago. When that happened, was Jamie Lee with that one? Jamie was there. I don't know what Mr. D was. We were doing our thing, and there's people picketing out on the sidewalk. And they're all wearing black, and the girls were wearing, when I say short shorts, short shorts. Halter tops. Guys are all blacked out. They didn't look out. They were all like they were at a funeral or something. And they're holding signs, go home to your family, there's no God. I mean, all these things. Pastor Steve from River of Life and I, a couple of us pastors, decided to go out and pray on the sidewalk. And then we went to their leader, who was a professor at Kirk Group, I won't mention her name. We prayed and we said, hey, bring those signs in here. Join us. And they're like, what? So we grabbed their signs from them and held them up during our prayer session. And then they came on the grass. And then two of the kids put down their signs. They felt the love of Christ. They put them down and walked away and walked over to us. It was the most beautiful thing. Like, you know, it was all God, it wasn't us. And then when they went to leave, we gave the professor a hug. For this day, when I see, for months, we run into her afterwards at certain things. I blessed Jim. I blessed Steve. And then they quit picking. They never did it again. How did we do that, people? Did we yell? Did we threaten them? Were we rude to them? We loved them right where they were at, and we embraced them. That's what the love of God can do. Amen?
Amen.
If we truly live as we're expecting Christ to come again, people, hear this. How would that change who you are? How would that change how you act? How would that change the way you worship God? Jared talked about worship. Worship, what worship is in his sermon. And we decided that worship wasn't just the music, right? The piece of it, really what it is. But everything we do, we can do in worship. Because if we're doing it, it shows we worship. Good deeds don't get you there. Everyone knows that, right? You're doing something, but not the Bible. But I think, and I think Jerry and I have talked about this before, I think by your deeds, it's evident that you love Jesus. Does that make sense? So I think when we love Christ, Christ expects us to do good deeds. So you see how people can confuse that? Good deeds don't get you there. Good deeds shared there, for lack of a better term. Everyone follow me on that? I want to make sure I'm articulating that correctly. When I was writing it, I was getting a little messed up. treat people if we really believe Jesus is really going to come? Bless you.
Thanks.
You're welcome. How would we be different? We know, oh, Jesus is going to come again, going to come. Okay, people, he's going to come. It's not just a fairy tale. You really need to start believing that. Not with this, your heart. And I tell you, if you start believing that, you'll make a change. There'll be changes in your life. All the victims should stop. All that you did, you shouldn't, why didn't you get it, will be like, awesome. You're forgiven. I'm extending grace to you. I love you. We need to love on people more and extend and give grace and forgiveness and set the example by doing that. People, it's not about us, it's about Him. I coined a phrase a few months ago, and I really want to make it into a bumper sticker. It's not your way, it's not my way, it's Yahweh. I really believe that. And our personal us's have a hard time believing that. Wax on. Don't we? So here's a question for us today. If we lived as we expected Christ to come again, how would we change things? Question number one. Take notes, people. Mental or the pen. If we lived as we really expected Christ to come again, how would we change things? Number one. And number two, neither one is more important than the other. The second question is, how would it change us? So how would it change things, and how would it change us? If we truly believe during this So during this time of Thanksgiving, because we just had Thanksgiving, if we really truly believe that Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ is coming again, and actually live that show that we believe that, what would we look like? What would it look like? I have a feeling, not speaking for myself, it would look quite different, don't you think? We'll get a few yeses. Are we looking for Christ to come again, or are we comfortable with the way things are? You know, are we believing the Jesus of the Bible, or are we believing the American Jesus we chose to believe in, or in some cases we've designed, compartmentalized the way we want Jesus, and the way we want Jesus to help us, and when we don't need Jesus, Jesus unconditionally loves us and extends grace to us and forgave us. Does everyone understand that? Jesus forgave us. We need to live like that. We need to stop some of our habits. Stop being the way we are. And just saying that's our personality, we clash. Nice person, but we clash. That's us, not God. You can't pick and choose that. And our lineage with our neighbor proved it. It took a couple of years, but tenacity prevailed. And out of that trial came perseverance, and out of that perseverance became a relationship. Now with that relationship, we share the love of Christ. You see how that works? You have to get the relationship first, right? Then get a relevant relationship, find stuff to talk about and be in common with, and get rid of the American Jesus. Go back to the Bible Jesus. In our passage, Christ pointed out that to those of the time of Noah, the world had gotten to a place where God felt that starting over was the only thing he could do. It got that bad. Think about that. But he chose a man, Noah, and his family to be the seed for the new season. So what did Noah do? He started building this great ark, and people were looking at him like, wait, insane? Could you imagine? No water anywhere near. Thousands of miles. And people just battled him the whole way, but he stayed focused on Christ. Then he started getting animals and putting them in the boat. Could you imagine what people were saying then? What are you doing? Well, I got the animals and put clean and the unclean. God told me to do this for this big flood on the boat. Dude, you really need to go check yourself in somewhere. He never gave up. He never stopped representing God. Never. In everything he did. The Lord was quite clear of all this, down to the dimensions of this giant ship. You'd be amazed, because we all know of Noah's Ark. Right down to Noah's Ark. Make a note of that, Noah's Ark. Here's another thing to do this week. There's only two little piece things. Look up Noah's Ark and the dimensions. You'd be blown away. And then you'd imagine building this in the middle of sand and dirt. But the people around Noah didn't listen, and Noah warned them. Because God told him, he warned the people what's going to happen. Things didn't change, right? Here's what God's going to do. And they're like, yeah, okay, Noah. When you quit smoking that cactus, it's messing you up, bro. He never, ever gave up. They mocked him. They even told him that he was crazy. He shared the Lord's love. And they said, there's no more. There's no more. Knock it off. All these things. And I'm going to ask you this. If one of those people had been humbled enough to believe in the Lord's power and to believe what Noah was saying, I believe that he or she would not have been turned away to get on that boat. I believe that one. They would have been permitted passage on that ship. Not one person would listen the whole time. In speculation, but I believe our merciful Father God would have granted them such a request. They would have been on there. Because if more people were following Christ, I think there would have been more boats. You know what I'm saying? Or ships. But instead, the people chose to eat and drink. And it says this. And be merry and go on with weddings and all this drinking right up to the point the Lord shut the door on the ark and sent them away. The same day they were having parties around the community. They were caught up in themselves so much they didn't take the warnings or the signs seriously. Have we ever done that? We get caught up in a situation or something so much that we're so tunnel visioned that we don't see what we really should be doing. Because things didn't go our way, we're not listening to anybody, and you know what? One of those anybodies could be Jesus. Jesus could have sent them a message to give you, like they did Noah. Like they did thousands of people. It's all over the Bible. It's all over the Bible. You need to be aware that God may be sending someone to send you a message. It's prophecy. Be aware that someone's going to come and do something in your life or be put in your life to help you change or to help you together share Christ. Quit looking at people with that. How many people in this room are saved and love Jesus Christ with all their heart? You don't have to raise your hand. How many people would believe that you love Jesus from your past, from the things you did in your past? How many people would believe that Jesus Christ is in your heart and sent you angels all around you, like Michelle's going through right now, sent her angel to change her life? How many days sober?
98.
98 days sober. Off one thing. How many days off the other thing?
26 months.
That's why Sharon was here. Kristen and I were in there one day and said that. That's why she held on, to make sure Michelle was where she needed to be. That was totally God. Now, it'd be crazy to sit here and tell you that I think the end's coming tomorrow. Okay, I'm not one of the disciples that thought they had to get ready right now. But I tell you, it's coming. Get ready. Have a watchful eye and stay away from the thief. body and Satan in the morning. Put on your armor in the morning. Because as closer it gets to the end coming there, the more Satan's coming in to bash it. I promise you. I promise you. People, we gotta stop what we're doing today, right? For real. Pastor Jerry and I, Pastor Jerry, we're available if you need to talk. And anything we talk, pray, or talk about is completely confidential and it has to be. There's legality issues there. And we love you so much. Call us. Call us if you need to talk. Call another congregant member. Don't stay away from your family here because things aren't right in life. We all make mistakes. I even make mistakes. There's things that aren't right with me. Maybe you can come in. But really, it's things that I need improvement on with you. Can we live as we're expecting the Lord to come? Can we do it? Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ is coming again. One more thing. Remember, it was Jesus himself that told us to be ready at any time. It wasn't Matthew or Luke or Mark or John or Malachi, you know, any of those, Paul. It was Jesus himself. So today we remember that call, and that call is this. We need to look for God in unexpected places, and more importantly, in unexpected times. Jesus could be sitting right next to you, or a message from him. I want to get Jared and Terry down here. Pastor Jared, Pastor Terry. We're going to do this through this Advent season, what we're doing right now. And then there's a prayer. Mom and Dad, can you come up here too? For those of you that don't know, some of the new people, Nancy Anderson, as most of us call Mom and Dad, is the head of our prayer team. This woman is praying every day for you. Some of you by name. But for our church family all the time. Jared's in prayer all the time. Terry and I, and the devil, let me tell you, Terry and I had a meeting 3 or 4 weeks ago, before I went to close over again. And we said, we're going to start meeting once a week. We loved each other. We broke down. We said, you know, for 6 months we've gotten away from our nucleus. Well, maybe longer. Then we're going to start meeting. You know, we haven't met since. That's the devil. Finding some excuse. And the devil's been attacking me this year like you have no idea. So most of it's my fault. But I'm going to tell you something. You need to love all people and we need to be together to battle the devil. I'm a tough guy. I'm not even saved. With God, I'll kick his down. So we need to adjust God. And I want to be accountable to you guys publicly. Three of us that we're going to meet once a week. I want to be accountable to everyone here, no matter what's happening. I don't care if we're sick, we'll get each other sick. No, for real. We need to meet once a week. We lead this church. And this church hasn't been being led. So I apologize personally for that, as a lead pastor. Well, co-pastor. So here's what we're going to do today. I was just honest with you publicly. I'm not afraid because I'm going to give it to God today, all this junk. We're going to pray and walk around and pray like we did a couple weeks ago. We want to pray with you so we can all publicly, you don't have to get up and say anything. When we pray with you, just give it to God. Say, God, this Advent season, I'm going to stop this. I'm going to start this. Don't come all negative, like I'm going to stop this. God's grace, you forgive me for all that. Let's do it in a positive way. God, I'm going to start doing this. I'm going to try hard to do this. I'm going to accomplish this. I'm going to beat this. If it's a drug problem, I'm going to beat it. If it's an alcohol problem, I'm going to beat it. If it's a porn thing, I'm going to beat it. Any addiction, I'm going to beat it. And then say, no, God, I'm not going to beat it. We're going to beat it. You and me. Can we do that? Can we try that? Let's pray. We're going to walk around and pray with you. Father God, as we publicly share some things we're going to do, I want to pray right now that we have the courage to follow up. That it's just not a hype day today, that we're really going to follow up, Father God. We're going to make some changes. And we're going to extend grace to people like we've never extended grace before. Ever. We're going to forgive people, Lord. We're going to love on them the way you forgive and love on us. Lord, be with me as I make some of these changes. Be with me as I shine you in all that I do, Father God. Heal me of these illnesses. Heal me of these addictions. Heal me of this hatred. Heal me of anything I'm doing that's not with you. And Lord, give me the strength. Give me the strength. Give me the power to just shine you. Give me the power to love you, Lord. Give me the wherewithal, Father God. You tell us to be ready to have a watchful eye, to watch out for the thief. Break this addiction, Father God. Heal our families. Heal our homes. Heal our hearts. Lord, we want to be a church of power for you. We want to be a family that's together. We want to be a family that's not afraid to go out and share the love of Christ with people. And Lord, we know you can change us. We know that you have the power to be behind us, no matter what we're doing. Father God, as we're walking around the prayer a little more, let us inhale you. Holy Spirit, come to everyone in this room. Holy Spirit, be here for us. Some of the changes we have to make, God, are going to be hard because it's about us. And it's so hard for us to make it about you sometimes. Teach us, Lord. And Lord, lastly, but certainly not least, let us learn how to hear from you. You know, it's good to hear from each other. It's good to share. But teach us how we can hear from you. Show us how to extend grace and mercy and to forgive. Oh, we love you, Lord. And you're precious. I can't wait for him to come again, son's name. We thank you. Amen.
As we talked about hope today and managing unexpectations, God calls me to some scripture in Hebrews. And Christian mentioned our radical series and hope in God and the things that we go through. And here is what the writer of Hebrews wrote in chapter 10. The section's titled, A Call to Persevere. This is where we can get hope. Starting at verse 19, the writer says, And so, dear brothers and sisters, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. By his death, Jesus opened a new and life-giving way through the curtain into the most holy place. And since we have a great high priest who rules over God's house, let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting Him. For our guilty consciences have been sprinkled with Christ's blood to make us clean, and our bodies have been washed with pure water. And listen to this verse. Let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep His promise. Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. And let us not neglect our meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now, that the day of his return is drawing near. This holiday season, this Christmas season, we celebrate his first coming. And as we go to communion, as we get ready to have the Lord's Supper with one another, I'm reminded from that passage that when Christ was on the cross, when his body was broken as we'll break bread, and his blood is shed as we take of the wine, that when he died, the curtain that was between the holy place and the most holy place, and see, the most holy place was only for a priest, only once a year. That curtain was ripped from top to bottom, which allowed us access directly to God. And that most holy place that used to be in the temple is now right here. And it was because of what Christ did on the cross that that happened. And as we take part in this meal, we're reminded of those things, because while he was having that final meal with his disciples, he took the bread and he broke it. This is my body, broken for you. Take it. And then a little later in the meal, he took the cup and he poured the wine in it. He said, this is my blood shed for you. Take and drink. And we are commanded by Christ that as often as we do these things, as often as we take part in this meal, that we do so in remembrance of him. What an amazing time of year for us to be able to take communion and remember him as we prepare to celebrate his birth. As always, we say, you do not need to be a member here, just be a member of God's family. Take a piece of the bread, dip it into the cup. Father, we thank you for this meal that you provide. We thank you for all that it means. We thank you that your son died on the cross, his blood was shed, his body was broken, and that ultimately that curtain was torn from top to bottom so that we can have you dwelling within us. We are your temple, Father. And as we do things to bring glory to you, we also do that by taking care of our body, which is your home. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. If you need prayer, please see Chris or I on the other side. Please get with me. Please come down the center and exit off to the side.
Thank you.
Lord, as we get ready to end our service today, I think we said it all. We want to better ingest you, better represent you, better organize our lives and our personality changes and evolve you. Make a change in us. And teach us how to hear from you. Because we're quick to speak, always, really slow to listen. Give us a quiet time where we can hear from you. Break our tunnel vision so we're aware of our surroundings. Because you're there. And there's no way we can see you with our tunnel vision. And Lord, be with us today as we celebrate the life of Cheryl and Paul. Celebrate. Changes and love she had. Through the good and the bad and the ugly. We need to do that. Let's us represent like that. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Amen.
We'll be back in here for our celebration of life. Thank you.
Thank you.